Hi everybody, welcome to the show.
Welcome back to our channel. My name is Amanda.
And I'm Stefan.
And we are the teachers, homeschoolers, and parents behind this channel, Raising A to Z, where we talk about all things homeschooling. So today, this was a requested video. We had a couple people ask us for this video on Instagram, and they wanted to know, as a new homeschooler, what are some of our tips and tricks to help you guys when you're just starting out homeschooling? Number one, you need to deschool. We have a whole video about deschooling, but basically you need to take some time to get the idea of school out of your head and to just let your kids have time to figure out what they like, what they're interested in, and to get into like what is your natural rhythm of your day. That is our first tip. If you want to see that video, it'll be up there and you can check that out.
And our next tip for you is to find your why. And we know for a lot of homeschoolers right now, their why is because of COVID and because of the pandemic. But you know, there are so many other great benefits and reasons to homeschool. So if you think about some of those things and kind of have them in your head, that'll just make it so much easier when you have some hard times. Because homeschooling is a journey. It's lots of ups and downs. And when you're in those, you know, low points on the roller coaster, it's good to think about why you're doing it.
So it might even be a good idea to like write down your reasons why and have them either like on a note on your phone or a sticky note on your fridge, just having them there to like remind you why you're homeschooling for those days when it sucks.
And we have a video about that too, so we can probably link that as well.
Yeah. Our next tip is to try not to be school. When we look at the word homeschooling, a lot of people focus on the word school, and the real focus should be on the word home. Like, you're in your home. It is a natural place for families to gather and your family to spend time together and connect. The focus when you're homeschooling should not be on recreating school in your house. Some people do.
Yeah, people do, but often it's people who are starting homeschooling will start to try to recreate school in their home, and then they see that that's not really always the best thing for them, and then
it's one of the first homeschooling styles people start with, and
the
it's
quickest
often,
to abandon. Right?
Yeah, it's abandoned very quickly. Just think, you don't need to teach 7 or 8 subjects every single day. Yeah. Schools don't. They don't teach every subject every day.
You don't need to sit in a desk to learn.
You don't need to be like spending hours and hours doing workbooks. Like, it doesn't even take that long to do homeschooling. Yeah. It's a significantly shorter amount of time. So be flexible, take breaks in your day, and find out when your natural learning times for your family are. Like, it's very natural for us to read a book before bed with our kids. Yeah. And we read like a chapter out of a novel. That's kind of our bedtime story routine. And that's just a natural way to do our reading. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be like, okay, we are getting up and we're reading at 9 o'clock every morning. Well, 9 o'clock isn't really a great time for us to be reading. It just doesn't fit in our natural flow. So
So find what works for you and for your family, and the schedule can take any shape or form.
Our next tip, if you're starting homeschooling, is to start with like 2 subjects max when it comes to like workbook subjects. A lot of parents are looking for curriculum, and we recognize that, but you don't need to jump in and start with, you know, language, math, spelling, science, history, geography, art, phys ed, music. Like, you don't need
it's
to
overwhelming.
Do, it's too, that's too much to start. So our recommendation when people ask us is to always say start with 2 subjects. Most people will pick language and math. It's a common duo to start with. And just start from there and, you know, give it that a month and just let it kind of sit. Because doing 2 subjects is very doable. It's not overwhelming, and it gives you a chance to like see what your kid's natural flow is gonna be, what their learning styles are. Is this working? Is it not working?
Yeah. And it leaves room for other interests too, right? So you're gonna see your kids might be interested in other things, and you'll take note of what other things that they wanna do and learn.
And that doesn't mean that you're not learning just because you're not doing other subjects. Mm-hmm. Like, you can go on nature walks, and you can
sing, you can play music, you can
let them draw 45,000 photo pictures like Alexi does. Like,
you can go for bike rides and walks and play games and
It's all learning. It's just not seated, structured learning. So start with 2 subjects, because you can always add more on as you go.
Yeah. And another tip for you is to try unit study instead of trying to incorporate a whole bunch of different subjects into your homeschooling. So doing a unit study allows you to focus on one thing for a period of time and really dive in deep.
Yeah, so instead of trying to teach science and history and geography, maybe for 1 month, focus on like one science topic and dive really deep into that. And then the next month you can switch and do like a history topic and dive deep into that. And then you're only doing, in terms of like structured learning, you're only doing 3 or 4 subjects at a time instead of trying to do 7 or 8 all the time.
Yeah.
And just to like break it down a little bit more, if you're trying to follow the Ontario curriculum, which I know a lot of homeschoolers are right now because of COVID and with their plans to send their kids back to school, just breaking this down, for example, if you have a grade 7 student and you wanna break this down, there's 4 topics in the Ontario curriculum for science.
Yep.
And then there's 2 history topics and 2 geography topics, which ends up being 8. So there's 8 topics there. If you did a month on each, that would be 8 months, and that still gives you lots of time in your school year to tackle other things that they're interested in. And you're still covering all those subjects. Because I think a lot of people think like when we're in a classroom, they're doing these subjects every single day, and that's not true.
Yeah.
Like science is often only like 2 times a week for like 40 minutes.
Yeah.
So if you're doing one subject hardcore for a month, you're probably doing more than they would be in the classroom. Yeah.
So don't make it too hard for yourself.
Yeah. Unit studies are also great for like a large age spread. So you can pick a topic and dive deep, and just the younger kids pick up what they're interested in. The
older kids get out of it.
Pick up what they're interested in, and you can study one thing as a family instead of having to find subjects for all of your kids.
Yeah. So another tip or trick for you is to establish a routine. So we're not necessarily talking about establishing a schedule. You'll see a lot of people come up with like really strict homeschool schedules, and that can be very overwhelming. Just a kind of general routine throughout the week to help you, you know where your kind of landmark things are.
Yeah. So for example, we know that on Wednesdays we're going to playgroup, and that is going to be kind of what we do in the morning. On Thursdays, at some point in Thursday morning, we're going to do some baking. Like these are just little things that we have kind of put into our week, and it just gives us like a purpose of what happens every day, but we don't have to think about it. Like it just takes the mental work out of trying to figure out what you do every day. It's just,
you don't have to come up with what's coming next.
Right? Yeah. It's easy. We know what's going to happen. And then we like stick to it, but when we deviate, it's just like the kids think it's so exciting when we deviate from the routine.
It's okay to deviate.
Yes, it's okay to deviate, but then all of a sudden like a random Thursday morning doctor's appointment becomes like a field trip. It's like, ooh, it's something different, right?
Yeah.
Kind of like on the same page as having a routine, it's nice to have like little many fun things that you have planned in your week that are kind of consistent. So
things to celebrate, right?
Things to celebrate. Like, so for example, we do Waffle Wednesdays. That came out because we go to playgroup on Wednesdays, and I needed the kids to have something that they would eat quickly on Wednesday mornings, and they love to eat waffles. They devour them. And so it has become Waffle Wednesdays. Every Wednesday morning they have waffles, and they get really excited, and they don't know any of their days of the week, but they know Waffle Wednesday.
Yeah, it's also Garbage Day.
It's also Garbage Day. Those are like our landmarks for the kids. But then also like we do like family pizza and movie night on Friday nights. And it's just these little things that are not a lot of work, they're not hard or expensive, but they just kind of give you these little things to celebrate. You celebrate the end of the week, your middle of the week, and it just makes it more fun.
Yeah, definitely.
And you don't have to really think about it. Another tip that we have is we highly recommend you have a quiet time in your day. Whether your kid, it's an hour or two, obviously depends on how old your kids are, but having a time where everybody finds their own space, finds a quiet activity, whether it's reading or drawing or Legos or something that they can do independently by themselves quietly, it is such a game changer.
Yeah.
Like it gives everybody a chance to get away from each other. So your introverts have a little bit of a break from each other, which like Alexi is very extroverted. Zoe tends to need a little bit more alone time.
Yeah.
She will go and like play in her bedroom, and they get that little bit of a break from each other when they need it. It also gives me a chance to have a break, because I know a lot of parents are always worried, like, how am I gonna deal with having the kids with me all day long?
Yeah.
Take the quiet time.
Yeah.
Like,
and don't take the quiet time to go and start planning and figure out what's coming next. That's your you time.
Yeah, like take an hour, have a cup of tea, put your feet up, watch a Netflix show,
read a book,
yeah. Do something you enjoy for that time that you can just like
relax
a little bit.
Yeah.
And then you have some energy to get through the rest of your day and to like jump into a unit study activity in the end of the day, yeah. Or go for a hike later with the kid. Like, you have that mental energy there. It does take a little bit of training with the kids to get them used to like what they can take out, cleaning up afterwards,
yeah.
What is too loud and what, like that kind of stuff. But once they've kind of get on the, like they're used to it, it is just so wonderful, yeah. To have the hour and a half. Our kids are about an hour and a half.
And that independent time for them is really good too. Mm-hmm. You know, the independent play and,
yeah.
You know, just unstructured, and they're figuring out what they're doing and
yeah.
How they're playing and all that stuff.
And it's always surprising what they come out with after quiet time. Like Alexi often comes out and she'll have like this very intricate drawing that she worked on, yeah. And...
Or a trap set up for dad.
Yeah, she'll make traps or... build a castle with her, like you're never really sure what they're going to come out with, but it's all things that have been set up that she can play with and they can access safely.
Yeah.
But they get to kind of create and have that independence too.
Yeah. Our next trick for you is a trick or a tip?
Whatever.
Which one is this, a tip or a trick?
I feel like it's a tip, but
okay.
They're all kind of tips and tricks too.
Our next tip for you is to get outside. It's really important to get outside whenever you can. Even if it's raining or snowing or cold, just being in the outdoors is so important and it revitalizes.
And I struggle with this. Like, I'm not really an outdoorsy person and I have to remind myself to get outside and take the kids out. And I always feel better once we've been outside for a little while. Yeah. But I do forget. Like, even I forget to go outside.
I don't forget because I feel drained if I'm not outside
at
some
point. Yeah, different personalities. And it's always surprising what they'll do outside.
Yeah. Yeah, all sorts of different things, but...
And like we said, like he said, the weather. Like, on our kids love to go out on a rainy day. We have, like, rain suits, and they go and they jump in puddles, and they call it worm day, because all the worms come out of the grass, and they're on the concrete, and they can see them, and so we'll go and count worms or collect worms. Like, it's...
And talk about why the worms are coming out on rainy days, too, right? And there's so many... You know, learning happens anywhere, anytime, and so when you go outside, there's still lots of things to learn.
And with older kids, you can grab like a notebook and a pencil and go and do like nature studies and sketch what you're seeing out for your walk, or like all kinds of things that you can do.
And this summer, Alexi's really enjoyed having me look things up on with like Google Lens. So
if
we see a flower or a plant or a bug or something that we don't know what it is, we'll look it up. And so she's been really enjoying that this summer.
Yeah, and it's easy and it's free. Lexi in the winter loves to like run on the tops of snowbanks. Like that is like her like little free parkour course.
Yeah.
And so like just getting outside is good for everyone's physical and mental health. Our last tip is to read, read, read. I think a lot of people underestimate the power of reading and what you learn when you're reading. Just read a lot. Read picture books and poetry and chapter books to your kids of all ages. You can read at bedtime. You can use audiobooks. Like, audiobooks are this like amazing new creation basically in the last couple of years that have like changed reading, because you can have kids listening to a book while they're playing Lego or with their cars, and it's still the equivalent of you reading them a story. Like, it is the same brain effect.
Actually, it's not necessarily a new thing. My mom used to make audiobooks for me when I was like 5, which is a long time ago.
Yeah, but like they've really grown in popularity.
Yeah,
that was kind of my point. But like the same idea, like your mom would, she used to record it on a cassette, right?
Yeah.
And read it to you.
She had a little glass that she would ding so I knew when to turn
the page. But a lot of people do this with audiobooks nowadays. They'll get the audiobook on their phone or whatever, and then they'll get the kids the hard copy of the book, and the kids will read along with the book. And it's the same thing for them. And it's a great way to learn. It's a great way to like imagine.
Yeah.
And it's so easy. Like once you put in audiobooks and reading, and they just get so much out of it. So just read. Lots of reading with your kids.
So those were our 10 tips for you today, and we hope that you got something out of them, that you found them informative. And we have lots of other videos, so go check out other playlists and videos and lots of stuff to help you get started homeschooling.
Yeah, if you like our videos and all that, please subscribe. We put out a brand new video every Monday morning. And we also are very active on Instagram and Facebook. We put out ideas of what we're doing with our kids, and we always answer DMs and private messages and comments. So if you have any questions or anything like that, leave them below or in our DMs, and we will definitely get back to you. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.
See you next time.
Bye-bye.